r/AskReddit. What is one rule that was implemented at your school or work that backfired horribly? Germany military introduced working hours at the beginning of 2016. Like you now have clocked hours of 41 hours per week. It was a clusterfuck in the Navy. We used to have a 23-person guard at the ship. This means 24 hours for these 23 people. And we only have 180 people at the ship. So we had basically half of the ship permanently only acting as guards, and not doing anything else. The technical department was used up in a way that they literally couldn't work anymore without accumulating overtime hours. This led to them changing it to a 5-man guard consisting of 4 technicians and 1 petty officer. The military guard was changed to civil contractors. But now the technicians still had way too many overtime hours. Also, nobody could sleep on the ship anymore. Now they had to provide housing for around 1,000 to 2,000 people who used to sleep on the ships. Now they had to reopen and renovate parts of an old base to house these people. But the old base was pretty far away, which is why they also needed bus drivers to get the people to the ships. It was still not enough housing, thus they also began to rent out entire city blocks to give to the soldiers. Also, they paid around 500 euros per month for every career soldier that did not live in that city and had a family, so he can rent out an apartment. But people were still pissed, because now the engineers still accumulated too many overtime hours. Thus they made it that each shift only one engineer is active and does all the work, while an unlearned guy just sits in the server alliance room. Thus the engineers were really pissed. Next came, people used to get around 50 euros or something for each day of guard duty. Some people used to do 20 days of guard each month to get some 800 euros or something extra per month. Some even had this in their financial planning. But this is still not all. The civil guard said that they will only do it if we have a way to prevent people from entering the ship, or at least knowing if someone entered, because the civil guards are not allowed to enter the ship because of missing security rights, like you have to get a whole lot of background checks to enter the ship and there is a lot of stuff you aren't allowed to talk about. Well, we did not have locks. You don't need locks if every place is guarded at gunpoint. And we couldn't put locks on it either, because the fire safety said that every exit and entrance needs to be able to be accessed. So now we had to put on seals onto every entrance, done by the petty officer. We have ships with 80 plus entrances, so they also felt fucked. TLDR, military put work hours in place, everyone was pissed. P.S. They also introduced something around the way of after every 24 hour time of being at work, like a single guard duty, military personnel has to get 8 hours of break, which would fuck off every 3-day weekend guard duty. But literally everyone ignored it. The officers were just like, if nobody reports it, there is no problem. I worked in a fake Tudor steak and seafood restaurant back in the 70s. The management hired 14 to 16 year old boys to work as prep, bus boys, and dishwashers. They had to report by 4 p.m. Most got off school between 3:15 and 3:30, so they didn't have a lot of time to eat, to get everything ready for the dinner shift. The rule. The boys could not eat on shift, only break, even though they were surrounded by food. Plus, the management insisted they buy everything at staff price, 50% off retail, and get the manager's okay before eating it. Doesn't sound onerous, but when you only have a 15-minute break, are you going to spend 5 minutes of it finding a waiter to key in your order and a manager to sign it? End result, they stole food like crazy. We used to serve jumbo shrimp cocktails with 6 shrimp for $3. Told you it was the 70s. They were in the walk-in fridge, all assembled in large martini glasses with the cocktail sauce in the middle. Well, very few made it out to the customer with 6 shrimp. Bus boys would just open the door, pop a shrimp in their mouth, and close it. We got used to serving 5, then when management cut the order back to 5, we would end up serving 4. One night, the management forced me to take out a shrimp cocktail with 3 pieces on it. Eventually, they decided to serve peel and eat shrimp instead. We also used to serve Sara Lee cheesecake and black forest cake for dessert. The kids would cut the whole cakes into slices and put them on plates, ready for the waiters. But the bus boys would also take a piece for themselves. However, you can't put a whole piece of cake in your mouth. like you can a shrimp. So if someone opened a walk-in door, the busboys, not knowing if it was management or another busboy, would immediately jettison their plates, complete with half-eaten piece of cake, into the nearest available hiding place, which happened to be the large tubs in which we made our salad dressings. So, when we cleaned the tubs at the end of the month, we'd find 3 or 4 half-eaten pieces of cake at the bottom of each tub. Eventually, all the staff got together, and we agreed on the Treaty of the French. The French dressing was to spare these type of shenanigans, and whenever any of our friends or families asked what dressing we recommended, we'd always say I only have the French. TL. Doctor Restaurant management hired teenage boys, surrounded them with food, and told them not to eat. Worst rule ever. Suburban New England High School was angry that girls were breaking dress code with the length of their shorts in the spring. Girls complained that it was actually difficult to make fashion choices based on what stores are selling that also conforms to the dress code. As admin started becoming aware of just how widespread of an issue it was, they eventually decided it would be a good idea to crack down on the dress code firing squad style. Public, humiliating, and with no mercy. I shit you not, in the middle of high school instruction, a couple of administrators would patrol the school. Their job was to interrupt classrooms, select a handful of students who look like they may be violating dress code, 90% of the time all female, then take all of them outside of the room to check the length of their shorts. If you violated dress code, you were asked to switch into gym clothes or leave the school. Needless to say, people really freaked out. Before this policing style was incepted, the dress code was an issue between like 20 girls and the administration. Once they started pulling this shit, all of the students and teachers started talking about it. I remember having conversations in the middle of class about the unjust rules and enforcement of the dress code. Most of the discussion centered around how women's bodies are treated in society, and how puritanical views on sex and sexuality are a prison for many individuals and stigmatized groups in America. TBH, I think a lot of those conversations were really beneficial for me. Thankfully, the admins gracefully ended the policy and apologized when people started complaining en masse after like 2 days, lol. This whole thing was really controversial for a couple weeks, but everyone was really cordial to everyone else, and the community got stronger because of it. This is a policy used by a previous employer of mine, and to be honest, I understand the drive to increase representation within the office. In theory, the job has a basic minimal level of performance required, and so long as that baseline is being hit, it's difficult to knock an employer for attempting to create a more diverse workforce. The only problem was that we were all term workers, and we routinely faced rounds of layoffs every few months. Initially, we were told that the layoffs would be related to performance rankings, purely about production. Our pool of terms was made up of 4 white males, 8 white females, 3 females of Asian descent, 3 males of Asian descent, 2 indigenous women. They cut 13 people. All the white men, 7 white females, 1 male of Chinese descent. Gone. In the exit interview, we were able to get our personal stats as well as our departmental stats in order to self-rank. We were told to keep this information private and confidential, so naturally we all met for drinks that Friday and pulled the data. From there, it took only basic math to show that the remaining employees combined only accounted for about 9% of the pool's production. We had no recourse without demonstrating that we had pulled out stats in violation of the privacy agreement, but word of mouth spread among the permanent employees and it eventually came out that a little pool was being used to meet diversity quotas for the entire larger workforce. We also learned that 4 of the remaining employees were on performance programs because they had awful ratings in their roles. They were literally keeping poorly performing minority workers in seats in order to use their status to fill diversity quotas for the rest of the unit. Furthermore, the employer hired 3 more external candidates of minority race the following month, passing over the pool of laid off workers. That would have violated a collective bargaining rule, except that terms have 0 rights under the agreement. Ironically, the practice likely contributed to a rise in racism among the permanent staff. TL. Doctor, employer laid off higher performing term employees in order to cultivate a pool of minority workers to apply across the larger permanent workforce and meet diversity targets. Gilbert, Minnesota, 1989-90. In school suspension for everything. Taking away lunch time for everything. After school suspension for everything. I once got in school suspension for putting a pen inside my shirt. I had detention for not having a pen for English class. I did have a pencil. Detention for doing origami while watching a film strip. Ice for slouching in math class. Ice for disagreeing with a teacher in art class about perspective. I was right. He even used my analogy in class without apologizing to me for punishing me. I was forced to take a math test with my entire right shoulder torn. I couldn't move it at all, only my fingertips. Right shoulder so dead that I didn't even feel pain. It had happened that day after lunch due to an altercation. I should have been sent to the ER, but instead I had to go to math class. The teacher threatened to fail me unless I took the test then. All I had asked for was a day or so until I could use my right hand. I had to take it left-handed. Left hand doing the moving of my right arm, my right fingers doing the writing. I should note, fighting was not punished ever, nor was bullying. Theft was tolerated. My drafting teacher tore me a new asshole in front of the class, and then elbowed me in the solar plexus. Kids that had been bullying me for years came over to console me. I was crying like a kitty and they didn't tease at all. They put their hands on my shoulder, and told me that it was okay and the teacher was just an asshole. That's how bad the school administrators and teachers were. They were worse than bullies. Chatting in class, detention. Late 1 minute to class, detention 3 minutes between classes. You weren't allowed to carry a bag, so you had to carry all your books with you. It took 7 minutes to get to your locker and then to class. Everyone had to carry 4 or 5 textbooks with them everywhere. Also, some classes were more than 3 minutes apart, so you had to run. Running in the halls? Detention. We planned a walkout but everyone chickened out except for me. I stood outside in protest, but no one showed so. Eventually, I went to class. I was embarrassed for my cohort. The next year, the whole school marched in protest. I was in a different school by then, but my friend had organized it. Every student walked out and marched down Main Street during the day. Made all the papers. I don't know if it helped that much, but several administrators were transferred including the principal. Not a rule per se, but one of my greatest achievements during high school was creating the quotes doc with a bunch of my friends. It started in freshman year as a simple Google Doc to write down what our crazy band director would say. Halfway through sophomore year, we decided to add quotes from any other teacher and make the document viewable to anyone with a link. Cue it growing from a small 4-page document following the quotes of one teacher to an 84-page behemoth with a table of contents and a related email ran by a select few kids. You could send in a quote from a teacher to that email and someone would add it to the document. Only me and 10 other kids had editing privileges, and since editing it was anonymous, no one but us knew who ran it. When I graduated it was 102 pages long with quotes from 72 teachers spanning 4 years. Good times. Administration never actually did anything about it. Teachers loved it. There were printouts hanging in the teacher lounge of their favorite quotes. Sometimes they would repeat quotes in class for kicks. When we got a new principal in junior year, he was warned about paying attention to what he said, or else he might be recorded on the document. He only had 3 quotes on it when I graduated, and one of them was "This is even better than being on the quotes thing." High school was a lot of fun for me. The same friend group responsible for the quotes doc had this fucking massive email chain that lasted all high school, 32 person chain emailing all day every school day talking about everything under the sun, had our own weird and intense dramas. At the end of it, we had sent a total on 525,501 emails. No joke. We all keep in touch still, but sometimes I miss that ridiculous email chain. So I did distance education for the most of my high schooling. So a lot of the coursework was done at home, but 3 times a week all the kids in the area who did distance ed would meet up at a hub where we had teachers who could help if needed. Now I was an older student, due to reasons, mainly being a carer for my disabled mum, I didn't want to stress myself out too much and decided to do my HSC over 2 years rather than 1. This meant in my last year I was not only the oldest there, but a lot of the teachers would ask me to help other students as kind of a teacher's aide type thing. I didn't mind, and actually enjoyed helping. That was until they gave us a new teacher. At first she loved my help and treated me more of a colleague than a student, which was fine. This is how I had always been treated by other teachers. It worked. But here's the thing. I loved my energy drinks. Like a lot. And every morning this new teacher would comment about how unhealthy they are. And I would respond with the simple fact, well, it's the same caffeine and sugar content as 2 cups of coffee with 3 sugars in each cup, which is pretty much what she had each morning. Then one day, she said, we have made a new rule. No energy drinks in the hub. And at first I just didn't listen. I was going on 20 and just wanted to get my coursework done to get that stupid piece of paper. Then she pulled me aside and said, look, I said no energy drinks, and I went, yeah, but why? The teacher responded with, it's hard to explain to the younger students why you can have them and they can't. I almost rolled my eyes at her, but I didn't, because my mum raised me right. So I thought, if the issue was that she didn't want to explain that a legal adult, me, can make food choices for themselves / it was a bad influence to see me drinking them, I came up with a solution. I had one of those big reusable cups from the movies, and I would hide the can in there and drink through a straw so you couldn't tell what I was drinking. First day she was like, hey, is that an energy drink? And I just responded with, yes, but the younger kids can't tell. And that was the issue, right? Them seeing me drink it? I could see the anger and hatred in her eyes. But she couldn't really do anything. She had given me a solid reason why, as an almost 20-year-old, I couldn't have an energy drink for the few hours a few days a week I was there. And I found a solution to that. This was just one kid, but it was hilarious. In the late 90s, humorous graphic tees became a popular thing and the mall had a few stores that sold questionable taste shirts. Shits that said porn star, orgasm, donor, a headless guy holding a sign that says, will work for head. That type of thing. The school made a rule that, if your shirt was inappropriate, you would have to turn it inside out. A kid in my class shows up to school with a shirt that says, I'd rather be masturbating. The teacher sends him to the bathroom to turn it inside out. He returns with an inside out shirt that says, I put the foo in fun. The teacher doesn't realize it's the same shirt. So he takes it off in class and shows her both sides. He had a few shirts custom made with prints on both sides. She asks him if he has another shirt in his locker and he says, I have my gym clothes. She told him to go get the other shirt and change. He walks back into the class with a shirt that says, you're driving me knucking futs. The teacher said, just go to the office. So he goes to the office and tells them that he was sent there because of his shirt. So they say, turn it inside out and go back to class. So he turns his shirt inside out and walks back into the class with a shirt that says free mustache rides. She said, did you go to the office? And he said, they told me to flip it inside out and come back to class. The teacher sighed and said, just sit down. She went about teaching and we thought he won. But he ended up getting suspended for 3 days. When he returned from suspension, he wore shirts for probably a whole week that said, I love teachers, support your local teachers union, cops are the good guys, drugs are bad, wash behind your ears, etc. It was funny, because he made these overtly positive shirts and the teachers and students would try to read into it too much to see what they really meant. As if it was just a tongue-in-cheek thing that they didn't get. Eventually one of his positive shirts that he found said support single moms, but he claims he didn't realize that there was a silhouette of a stripper on a pole. He says he thought it was just a woman. So he got suspended again. As a side note, the same kid bought a blow-up doll and took her to every football game, basketball game, pep rally, etc. And gradually worked her into official school functions and brought her to school several times. For whatever reason, the teachers just gave up on that one. We passed her around over our heads at graduation. He even bought her a cap and gown. Edit. A lot of people have asked what he is up to nowadays. I'm friends with him on Facebook, and he is a truck driver and bodybuilding enthusiast. The dude is jacked now at 39 years old. Sorry, nothing really related to his HS shenanigans. I told this story before, but in high school they banged backpacks in classrooms. Everyone was pissed. Some girls started bringing bigger purses to put their books in, so a bunch of dudes brought their mom's purses in and were using those for school books. Administration and teachers got upset because we found a loophole, so they banned purses too. At which point a bunch of moms got upset because their daughters had to carry around tampons and stuff in their coat pockets, in addition to all of their books, notebooks, calculators, pen/pencils, and whatever else they had in those purses. Finally, the school let everyone have their backpacks back. Edit. Knowing that other places banned backpacks makes me feel a bit better. What would make me feel a lot better is going back in time and telling Mrs. Gaines that she can eat a bag of decomposing dungs for suggesting that we get rid of our backpacks. That lady hated teaching, and she hated students. She just loved control. Already having an authority problem, I bucked up at her more than once. I remember one story where me and a bunch of other seniors started completely assaulting each other. We'd pay each other compliments, but in an insulting tone, start to act like we were going to fight, then hug it out. We thought it was hilarious, but Mrs. Gaines thought we were being disrespectful to her authority because we'd completely assault each other a bunch outside of her door. Once we learned this annoyed her, we started to do it more, until some pink slips started coming out, and people were getting sent to the office for complimenting each other in a loud tone. What a joke of a teacher. Yup. Worst policy ever. I wish they'd get rid of it. In middle school, one of my best friends was being bullied by a group of three girls. It got really bad one day. I was chatting with my friend while she was getting her books out of her locker. The group of bullies strolled up and started saying stuff like, "Why do you always smell so bad, and your family is poor, and that's why you always smell like cat piss." It was normal verbal abuse and my friend was used to it and ignored them. Well, the main bully pulled out a can of Lysol from her purse and started spraying my friend, which caught her off guard and she fell down onto the ground. The bully didn't stop and continued spraying her and even got some in her eyes. My friend at this point is screaming and is curled up in a ball on the ground. Now you'd think one of the three teachers standing in the halls would do something. Nope. Nothing. Just stood there. And I knew I couldn't do anything because of this stupid zero tolerance bullshit. Other students were in the same boat as me. Students couldn't stop it, and teachers wouldn't stop it. Once the bullies were done, I helped my friend get to the nurse's office and get Lysol out of her eyes. We reported what had happened to the office. Office decided it was a fight and everyone involved was suspended for a week. And that includes my friend. The bullies even tried to get me suspended, but the teachers that witnessed it said I wasn't involved. So yeah. Getting sprayed in the face with Lysol by a group of girls that have been bullying you for years will get you suspended. Bravo, zero tolerance. Really stop the bullying and fighting. /s. Edit. This happened back in middle school. That was over 13 years ago. I was 12 at the time. I did not have a phone to record the bullying. Her mother did not care about what had happened. Police were not involved. Her mother didn't contact them and neither did the school. It was like nobody cared. And I honestly never thought to contact them myself because I was young and didn't think I could do anything. If I could go back, I would have protected her. But I didn't. Sorry everyone. My high school was trying to prevent a senior prank since the class before us had got a little out of hand. They basically told us not to have one, that they would get anyone who did anything in a lot of trouble, yada yada. So somebody has an idea, what if we do an anti-prank? The idea had floated around the halls and everyone knew what we were going to do. For an entire week, every senior was going to bring a potentially threatening item for a senior prank and do nothing with it. The week starts and that Monday, nearly the entire senior class carries a banana with them to every class. This is a school of 2,600 students, 650 graduating class. So there are hundreds of bananas being carried through the halls, teachers and assistant principals freaking out. By noon, an announcement was made that all bananas needed to be eaten or thrown away, or they would be confiscated. So by that afternoon, every banana was taken away from the student. The next day got even better. Somebody has the idea that we should all bring a gallon jug of water with us to class. And to no one's surprise, again there is an announcement that they are going to start taking up the water jugs for fear of what we are going to do with them. But this time, the students got creative. People are resentful now and not wanting to give up their precious water. Students are getting creative, hiding them in backpacks, avoiding teachers in the hallways, whatever it took to keep their water jugs. But alas, most of the jugs had been confiscated. So the students start taking to social media. Tons of tweets and mentions are going out to local news stations, TMZ, Opera, Ellen, you name it, they got mentioned. All of these messages are going out along the lines of school is confiscating all water, not allowing students to drink water #HIGHSCHOLDROUGHTTKXX#WERDYING#SENDHELP. You get the picture. Before the end of the day, two different news reporters were at our school. Guess we had the last laugh after all. TL, doctor, school made silly rules to not let us have a senior prank. We anti-pranked them, and their rules backfired, lots of negative press over nothing malicious ever happening. When I was a kid, there was three major things popular with boys in my school: UGIO, Pokemon and wrestling. UGIO cards were very popular, and pretty much every boy would bring in their cards to play during recess. After a while, too many kids couldn't handle losing all the time, complained to their parents, and their parents got the game banned in the school. So, kids shifted to Pokemon, and pretty much every boy would bring in their GBA or Nintendo DS. After a while of this, an old coot who lived behind the school started complaining that kids were using his Wi-Fi, which wouldn't have been possible if he had a password on it, but the school decided to bend to his will and ban games consoles as well. After this, we all decided to emulate WWE, but of course, being kids that didn't know it was scripted, led to us pretty much just beating the crap out of each other. There was far too many kids involved in it to properly punish anyone. We weren't playing around either. I can think of an incident where a kid slammed another on top of the principal's car, and another where a different kid tackled another into a window, breaking it. After a few weeks, there was an assembly held to deal with the issue, and everyone involved was in agreement that if we were allowed use our handhelds or play UGIO again, we'd stop, which of course, the school refused to budge on. A few months later, the school agreed to lift the bans on handhelds and UGIO cards, but at that point, most kids had lost interest in Pokemon and UGIO cards because they mostly played with them during recess. I was in that school for another 2 years after this, and the boys' pastime of choice remained beating the crap out of each other. To my knowledge, this continued for a few years. After I'd left too. In our shop, we use the big chisel tip sharpies to label material, so we can efficiently inventory it. We've got half a dozen guys that work in the shop, and naturally, we need a lot of sharpies. Well, oftentimes the sharpies are placed in the pockets of our employees, as they need them throughout the day, and they'll forget to take them out before they go home. So a lot of sharpies go home with employees and never come back. Because of this, we have to buy a bunch of sharpies. And they aren't especially cheap either. It doesn't add up to an amount that would make or break a company, but it's one of those things that bugs the boss. Asking everyone to bring back the sharpies isn't especially effective either, because A, bringing back the sharpies is admitting guilt, not like management would be upset about that though, and B, everybody uses sharpies, and they're expensive, so now they have free sharpies at their house. So I had the bright idea of having a contest at our company Christmas party in 2016. Whoever brought back the most sharpies would win a nice set of Craftsman ratcheting box end wrenches. It was very effective. All in all, we got back like 180 sharpies, and the wrench set went to the worst offender, who brought back like 70 sharpies by himself. Before we had the contest, I tried to tell the guys, we aren't doing this every year, because I don't want them to intentionally hoard sharpies for next year's contest, but they thought I was bluffing. So for the whole of 2017, everybody was happy to accidentally forget to bring their sharpies back to work, because they thought they were saving them up for the Christmas party sharpie contest of 2017, which, like I told them, was not going to happen, and didn't happen. So I think at the end of the day, our sharpie deficit is larger than it was in 2016, and we spent $80 on a tool set to basically encourage the guys to hoard more sharpies. My school used to have a ban on a spin-off handball game called 10th Grade Rules. For for my grade it was 4th grade rules, supposedly because the teachers couldn't resolve disputes when they came up, because they didn't know the rules. Not like they really paid attention to the playground anyway, they just stood in a corner while kids ran amok. Of course, the entire school revolted against this, posting up signs, going to the principal, pulling off pranks, etc. I took the route of writing up an official rulebook, about 30 pages long, for 4th grade rules, and writing a shorter book for 5th grade rules, so that you could go to a rulebook to resolve disputes. Teachers didn't care at this point, so when I showed them the rulebooks I created, they just shooed me away. Another kid started using the rulebook while doing a sort of black market handball, where you'd play by the book until a teacher came around. Then, one of the kids, usually a designated ref, would call out a code phrase in which the actual game would be suspended, and you'd start playing the original sanctioned 3rd grade rules, with line positions and member memorized. Then, once the teacher went away, everyone would smoothly transition into the way it was. It was surprisingly coordinated for a bunch of scurrily elementary school kids. After a while, all the teachers forgot about the ban and everything resumed as normal. I have no idea if the rulebook is still in use, or if indeed it still exists. I uncovered a bunch of my old writings and schematics a few years after I left the school, hidden in a box where I'd left it. The paper had gone yellow from exposure to the element, but everything was intact. Makes me wonder if my rulebook was still hidden somewhere. Thank you so much for watching. Please like and subscribe the channel.